So we have an appointment with MassDOT, and we have some new faces in MassDOT with some new roles. Actually, old faces, new roles.
That's right. Good evening, everyone. How are you tonight?
Good, how are you?
Good.
Go ahead and introduce yourselves.
Sure. All right, Jeff, go first.
I'm Jeff Anonsky. I work in MassDOT District 2 in the project section.
I'm Michael Trepanier. I am the Highway Division's project manager for the Route 9 reconstruction project.
I'm Mark Kolonowski, assistant project manager for the Route 9 construction project.
I'm Robert Materio, MassDOT out of Northampton Environmental.
Okay. So what would you like to talk to us about?
Okay. We had an agenda. You guys have an agenda of a list of items.
We do.
So I'm up first then. So we wanted to take, at the request of David, and actually we were planning on doing this, and it was quite timely given some of the work that is happening, the ongoing work and development of the Middle Street project, immediately dovetailing and coinciding with the limits of a future reconstruction project for Route 9. This is something that we talked about here briefly the last time we were here to discuss Middle Street reconstruction. Just an overview, the reconstruction from this point all the way down to South Maple Street is something that was identified in 2004 during the Connecticut River Crossing Study as a needed improvement to improve regional mobility and reduce congestion along the corridor. We have since taken a look at, there were a number of different segments of the corridor that were being proposed for reconstruction, and we're taking a more comprehensive look rather than the piecemeal approach that we had taken along the corridor from here towards Northampton. We recognize that from here to South Maple Street, there are a number of continuing themes, common themes, and then also unique themes throughout the corridor that required a more comprehensive review and project development approach. Most notably, the Connecticut River Crossing Study had a very generic recommendation to just widen Route 9 to 4 lanes. We recognize that in reading various documents that the town has prepared and in a more progressive approach at MassDOT, to look at what can we do to, in some portions of the corridor, to conserve pavement and not necessarily just blindly accept a four-lane alternative and look at maybe trying to approach what we call in the industry a road diet, maybe have a three-lane alternative with a center turning lane versus four lanes. And we're in the process now of developing and analyzing what those various alternatives would look like. We've prepared a project briefing, so we'll distribute that to you guys. And actually, we have also a map with all of the projects that MassDOT has either undertaken or will be undertaking in Hadley along the Route 9 corridor. So go ahead and distribute those as well. I continue. We expect to have a very robust public involvement approach for developing these alternatives, engaging not only Hadley, but also the other major regional stakeholders, the adjoining towns, the university, the Regional Planning Commission, the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission, and the Pioneer Valley Transit Authority. So, David, I believe you were on our invite list and maybe members of the board for a initial kickoff meeting with our stakeholders group at the district later this month, where we're going to talk about a lot of these issues and hash out some of the major desires and goals of each of the stakeholders, but recognizing that you guys have a sort of special status in that you are the host community for the project and for this particular state roadway. We've read your master plan, and we've read the 2004 crossing study, and we got some recurring themes about, and I think we've also had some experience working in Hadley and most recently here at Middle Street, that there is a strong community desire to preserve this part of town in its the rural character with its agrarian past and present tradition, but yet balance that with the need to accommodate the economic development that's occurred along Route 9, the existing trips that have been generated there, and start to take into account some of the growth that we can expect from future economic development along Route 9. I think there's been some recent stories in the news about land purchases and potential development further down the corridor, and we definitely are considering all of that. And we are very committed to not developing the alternatives and then ultimately the project's design in a vacuum. We want to have a very rigorous public engagement. Not only, this is the very first time we've spoken on camera and before a public body. So we wanted to come to you guys. We felt coming to you guys first was very important, getting some initial feedback from the host community and kind of hearing some thoughts. Primarily, what our approach will be, and this has been in concert in coordination with and collaboration with PVPC, looking at what's the best approach for prioritizing improvements along the corridor. So we've been doing a very west to east, it seems, a west to east approach through today from 2004 to 2015, and I think that may continue for a short bit, but we sort of inherited segments from history. There was mitigation requirements associated with the Lowe's development, the Hampshire Mall development, Home Depot development, and specifically Lowe's was tasked with paying for the design of that segment of roadway between their set drive and Maple Street. And it was going to look at, the purpose of that project was to increase capacity, widen Route 9, make it four lanes consistently to their site drive. When we started looking at the corridor as a whole, we realized that there was a much greater regional need to either enhance capacity or improve operations in one form or another. And we felt that in light of the Massachusetts environmental regulations and even federal environmental regulations, that whole corridor needed to be looked at with one purpose and need. Primarily, the need being that there's congestion along the corridor, and the purpose is to address that congestion with some form of transportation improvements. So those regulations require that we take a very comprehensive approach, prepare major environmental documentation through the Massachusetts Environmental Policy Act, National Environmental Policy Act, and so we had to take a step back. But working with PVPC, we're starting to identify new segments that may be different than the ones that historically were laid out. So at this point, we're developing the concepts and the entire project as one whole, from here at Middle Street all the way to Maple Street, where we have obviously congestion issues identified throughout the corridor. We have safety issues, safety crash clusters identified at the South Maple Street side of the intersection, and a couple other little issues, the Norwalk Rail Trail crossing under Route 9, a lot of major programmatic elements that we want to try to address as part of the project. Not only that, but also significantly improving multimodal accommodation for bicyclists and pedestrians on Route 9, not just on the rail trail. So those are some of the sort of big things. So we've broken this in the future, once we get past that preliminary design and alternatives development and have a preferred alternative, we think at this time it makes sense to look at the terminus of the Middle Street project here in front of the Farm Museum to East Street and dealing with the East Street intersection, and then having another major segment at South Maple Street and dealing with a lot of the operations and safety issues there. And then finally finishing the entire corridor from East Street to Lowe's, the Lowe's site drive. And that would really be the final piece, adding that final bit of regional capacity into, or vehicle capacity into on Route 9. So, That's where we're at. That's something that I think the district feels is the priority, is, you know, in terms of 1, 2, 3. The region is in agreement with that, and they're prepared to fund the projects once we've gotten them through a environmental and design process. They actually originally had the Lowe's segment from Lowe's site drive to Maple Street programmed on the transportation improvement plan for, I believe, 2017. We've advised them that we need more time to develop the project and spend more time working with the town, working with the community, and developing a project that everybody can at least have a built a reasonable consensus around, rather than just accepting the alternative from 2004 and based on a very lofty piece of data. So we're confident that within the next year we'll have developed conceptual alternatives, we'll be entering into the environmental process, and that within about 2 years we should have a preferred alternative and preliminary design for at least one of the first of the three segments. So the region's on board with that. We've preserved the overall project and its three phases within the long-range transportation plan at the regional level. PVPC is very supportive of this approach, and you know, really we want to hear from you guys and find out what your initial thoughts are.
Are the dates that we're looking at on here relatively?
Is that going to happen 2015 on what's said there?
Okay, so well, let me clarify what these are. So what you see on this map is first our DOT project number. In each of those dialog boxes, you see our DOT project number, the project name or description, its status in terms of project development, whether it's approved by our project review committee, what level of design it's at. So we have four phases of design, 25%, 75%, 100%, and I don't think you'll see it here. And final. So that may be that. Yeah. Okay. So that's what's represented there. The advertising date it's really much more of a wonky MassDOT term. When something is programmed in the TIP, in the Transportation Improvement Plan at the regional level, we match the advertising date to its programmed funding year. On this, you'll see there are advertising dates in 2021. The Lowe's segment is incorrectly showing as 2018. Right. So these are, I apologize for some of those that are in the future. They're probably not accurate. They're drawn from our system. So that's like a data dump.
So the 2015s are accurate?
So the 604035, the Middle Street and Russell, and Route 9 and Route 47 Middle and Russell Street, that's that final design. It's in 100% design, and we are planning on advertising that for construction in September. And I know Jeff's got some more details on that and some of the other items we have to discuss tonight, with construction likely beginning next spring. So the three projects I'm responsible for, Mark and I are responsible for, are the 605881, right just to the east of Middle Street, 605032, the Lowe's to Maple, and we don't actually have it shown here yet because we're going to be splitting that off at a later time in terms of just how we track our project numbers. The Maple Street intersection will be a standalone project as well. So those dates for 2018, 21, those, and then even further along, the bike and ped improvements at Westgate Center Drive, those are showing in 2021 as well, and those could happen sooner or maybe later. That's good. I'm glad you asked, though, because that is a little misleading.
See, the whole idea behind all of this was to get this opened up along with Pioneer Valley Planning. And I understand in the last 10 years the changes that have come down the road, along with UMass and the other colleges and transportation and everything you just addressed. But the biggest issue for taxpayers here in town are the infrastructure issues. And we need to address that before you make it look beautiful with that final coat of tar over the top, and we gotta go and dig it up and spend three times the money to replace it and patch it. That was the point I was trying to make at the last meeting. And mm-hmm. I understand you guys did a little bit of homework here now and really trying to address our issues here with the infrastructure.
Mm-hmm. I think are you referring to the water line?
Yes, water and wastewater. We've right. got water and wastewater.
Right? And I don't want to speak for you, Jeff. I think this is something you're probably more prepared to speak to. But just given the project timeline that Mark and I are working with, I think it will allow for a significant amount of time to accommodate those improvements in advance. And I think we've had, you guys have had some conversations about some cost-effective ways to make that a little easier. So I don't know, I don't want to move on if we're not ready to move on, but the point was taken.
So,
my only other question had to do specifically with the infrastructure, so I'd like to hear about that.
So, before you go there, so the project which is going to be advertised for 16 is going to be advertised for 16. It goes from Wally Street to the Farm Museum, correct?
Correct.
And that's on track, no changes. Right. All the way along.
Yeah, it's 2015.
Yep, that is the actual ad date, the current ad date, middle of September. So.
September, so we should be done with this by September.
No, that's the advertisement. It's done next spring.
16. So we're not even
gonna because then it'll take 5 months or so to get it bid and awarded, so probably start till next season.
So if we're really lucky, it'll be have the road be all torn up for graduation day at UMass, and it'll be really cool on town.
Get Nancy on the phone.
Right?
Okay.
So that project isn't going to change at all. And from our standpoint, we've already designed, we've already worked in the waterline issue up to that point. So that one we're all set as far as the.
Yeah, the only issue is us raising the money in order to fund our part of that project, which is going to be after the advertising day. You're advertising September 5th. Our town meeting when we'd be raising the money would be October 22nd. So we've had preliminary conversations with you before that timing lag works for you.
I think it will.
Yeah.
But our process, our bidding process is, and again, Jeff, stop me if I'm stepping on your toes, but our bidding process is quite lengthy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, advertising doesn't mean awarded to a contractor. Mm-hmm. There's quite a bit of work that goes on behind the scenes and in terms of that whole process, and generally it takes about 6 months.
Mm-hmm. So we have plenty of time to do our town meeting thing in October, and then you'll award and you'll construct in 16.
If it's approved at town meeting, of course.
Yep, we just need the estimate so that we can submit it to Boston for the agreement.
Right. And then we're going. Okay.
But it is a good opportunity. I think it's a good opportunity for synergy among the two projects and in long term to have that done and cleared out of the way for the major reconstruction.
Okay.
And as part of the water line, that is just to extend it from this existing project to East Street, or just a little past East Street?
It's just a little past East Street. I think we go to your project limit.
Goes right a little bit past the post office when it crosses there.
Yep.
Okay, so then the next part is your discussion about starting a community input into what's going on with the rest of the corridor.
Yeah.
So you want to start that? Do you have a timeline for when you really want to start?
Yeah, good question. So we wanted to kick off the project with our major stakeholders before going to the public at large so that we could respond to some of those major, I don't want to call them special interests, but interests, regional interests. From all three of the host communities, Northampton and Amherst, UMass, PBTA, to get some preliminary input there. Clearly, I'm anxious to get out to the public, especially now that everyone knows. But we don't think it's appropriate to have large-scale public meetings with school out of session, that there be some voices that may not be heard. It's summertime, everyone's pretty busy this time of year. We thought it'd be best to wait until September before we had a public informational meetings. But we wanted to start this process by coming here where we know we're broadcasting, we're reaching a much wider audience than we might anyway. So we thought this was a good idea, a good place to start.
A local media, just like your advertising through Springfield, would be a great starting point. For all the communities, not just us. You're advertising your Springfield area with your casinos pretty well, but
not sure there are casinos, but
I gotta blame somebody.
Not with the game.
But then again, you are.
And I am not authorized to discuss it.
Pass on that.
You are reaching a lot of Hadley people, because I understand this is one of the top West shows in this town.
Wildly
you
popular.
Keep believing that.
We can't figure out why.
It's nice to take us into consideration, since it does run through the majority of our town. And
definitely.
No matter what we do, we always raise some issues and criticisms from either end, either Amherst or Northampton. Whether it be going over the Coolidge Bridge and having a bottleneck there at the bridge, and we kind of fixed that a little bit last year, which makes it flow a little bit better, but it ties.
Four lanes on a bridge really helped out.
That was a good thing, you know. So.
And I think we have another project on the books to on the Northampton side.
A ramp right to 91?
Yeah.
Different ramp, yeah.
Ramp right to 91 yet? Or
not? That one. That one, I think, was the one that didn't.
You know, there was a couple other concerns that a few citizens had addressed at one time, and I don't know if you really addressed it or not. Were a set of lights on West Street at one of the intersections, either the east side or the west side.
West Street, that's further.
That's the common.
That's this one.
We don't want a set of lights there.
Well, I'm not sure.
Jeff's
taking a note, so
too, since that's been installed.
Might be something to look at and see if we actually qualify for warrants.
For warrants, right.
Put lights there?
I think
there's definitely a safety concern.
There's a safety issue. But it's not something that the lights are gonna actually the warrants probably aren't gonna find that. Because we do have accidents there, but we don't have a lot of accidents there.
Yeah, more than you know.
No, it's people turning that way when they want to go down West Street instead of using the lights as a safety issue. They choose to turn there and make a havoc of whatever. When the cars are going Indianapolis Speedway 50 miles or more an hour down there, which
they do it with gusto.
That's where that third lane is, a turning lane would be the best alternative all the way through.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Because it does, people turn, it holds up traffic.
But that's already been designed and built, so it's just,
it just has to be
readdressed whether you would consider turning lane or
turning
lights.
Those West Street people.
Yeah. And mostly it's people just cutting through.
But it's not the West Street people that turn there. It's usually people traveling to and from.
No, it was West Street people that had asked me.
All right.
So there's just one more topic I just want to acknowledge and have for your consideration is that, clearly further to the east of Route 9, there's been a significant amount of economic development over the last decade. We acknowledge that, and we're acknowledging that in your master plan that this segment of Route 9 is where the majority of your commercial zoning is located, and that is very apparent to us that is something that we have to balance as owners and operators of the roadway, the potential for increased trip generation with continued economic development and growth. With the need to continue to preserve Hadley in its current form, and especially towards this end of the corridor, managing that, not the expectations and the perception of what large modern roadways look like, and a lot of times they feel like what are perceived as highways. So. I just want to throw that out there that we know that there's a certain amount of traffic volume out there today, somewhere between 18 and 22,000 vehicles a day. That hasn't grown at the rate that we thought it would in 2004. In fact, statewide and even nationwide, vehicle miles traveled and vehicle daily trips are flat versus what was projected then. A lot of people have a lot of ideas as to why, but just is what it is. And we want to take an innovative approach to that. We see two distinct characteristics of the corridor as it exists today. The residential, the more residential piece down on this end, down here into the closer to East Street, and a much more commercial land uses towards South Maple. And that in our minds and in the minds of our designers, we're approaching the corridor really in those two major pieces, and of course at each intersection as well. So I don't know if there's a need to have any feedback on that, but or what if your land use plans have changed since your 2005 master plan. But that's definitely in our minds that there's pretty significant potential for new traffic generation along the corridor and the need to accommodate that for the long term and along the life cycle of the project.
In your commercial area, would you be thinking of more of a divided highway like you have down to the Amherst line now and some type of turn lanes? Or?
So between here and between about here and Lowe's, what the concept we're looking at now is one travel lane in each direction and a continuous center turning lane. It's the type of setting where you have a lot of different access breaks and the potential for left turns throughout the corridor that might accommodate that center turning lane well. We don't know yet. We haven't done any traffic analysis. We just finished our base survey and we have a base map. So we're starting to just put lines, crayon-like lines on plans. And that none of that has been through any sort of formal traffic analysis. It's right on the line of when, where national policy and guidance says you can do this. And of course, that is always, you always have to look at that on a case-by-case basis. But the two-lane alternative works right at about, according to the Federal Highway Administration and their policies, right at about 20,000 vehicles a day. And in that section, I think it's 18,000 today. You know, not accommodating for projected growth. So we don't know. And it's also a discussion between us, the district, the town, and all the other regional stakeholders as to what's acceptable. You know, in some settings, congestion during rush hours is fine. Out here, I think one of the unique conditions is that there isn't, like, at least I've never observed, and I've been here at least a half a dozen times specifically for this purpose, doesn't seem to be a rush hour. It seems like there's a rush, but I mean, last time we were here, when we came and met with you folks a couple months ago in the spring, during those exciting budget meetings, we didn't envy you that night. There was no one on Route 9 except down at the bridge, and then we got all the way to the other end of the corridor, and there was no congestion. We've been here at 11 o'clock, and you can't move. So, you know, we're sort of acknowledging that it's a unique corridor with some very funky characteristics that don't fit the traffic engineer's happy mold for AM, PM peaks.
As I said, over the past 10, 15 years even, you know, the four lanes on the bridge was a major improvement. There's still a pile of cars, but for just a limited amount of time, not an hour, hour and a half in line. And I'm sure you must notice that too. Yeah. The East Street light was a big improvement for the residents in the center of town to get across the intersection. Because I know myself, I'd come over to Middle Street to get across rather than trying to cross East Street before the lights, you know? And this is what I'm saying, that West Street, one West Street light may really improve the north-south across Route 9.
For
the center of town.
We'll look at it.
You know? So I just had two quick comments for you, then we can go to your next part of your presentation. But the first thing would be, you might want to look at UMass scheduling and Amherst College scheduling, and then take the UMass ITI traffic counts they have and start looking at that, because we have our traffic deals a great deal with what's going on at the campuses. When there's a basketball game and UMass is winning, traffic is high. So it's not, like you say, there is defined rush hours during certain days. Friday, everyone can tell you what the rush hour time is. Monday, the rest of the days, there's really not a rush. But then you put it in a special event, whether it be move-in day, which is the biggest special event, graduation day, but even the little ball games, football with Williams College and Amherst College, if they're playing, those are the events that get us the most. And you'll probably find all the information you need if you take the athletic campus schedules and compare it to the traffic counts on the UMass IT.
Yeah.
IT, was it ITE? IT? The UMass, the other cameras.
What do they call it?
I don't know offhand, but I know you're talking about.
Yeah.
So, well, I think that might be useful to try and capture what that data looks like in terms of counts and whatnot, but I guess the reason I bring it up, the reason I talk about rush hour versus not rush hour is a lot of times we get pushed at MassDOT. We don't do things the way we used to, right? I mean, we used to come in 50 years ago, 20, 30 years ago, highway department says, you need this big roadway and we know what's best for you, right? We have a very different approach nowadays. Yep. We have a much more open ear. And we get some folks who believe that there should be no congestion ever, and we have others that say, you know what, we can live with it for an hour a day or for a couple hours a week so that we have a more livable roadway, especially on the end that's closer to the center of town, has residential uses. We're very sensitive to that idea.
So now that you said you're sensitive, the other issue.
Just open yourself up.
The Mass DOT's complete streets project policy. You gotta think out of the box there, man. You made this policy, not you. I'm talking the bigger guys. They made this policy complete streets. You will have sidewalks, you will have bike lanes, and they'll be on both sides, and then you'll have to take care of the traffic. Complete streets is very important. Tying the whole environment together is important. But when you get out here to the rural area, which we are kind of rural, and the fact that Mass DOT doesn't plow their sidewalks, it's a big, big burden for a little community like Hadley to all of a sudden get 5 miles of sidewalks we have to plow. People want to use the sidewalks, people complain. People want to use transit, they complain they can't get to the bus stops. We have to come to some agreement between the town and Mass DOT how we handle those. And there's ways to do it. But there might be some sections of this new development where we say, well, we're not going to do 2 sidewalks on both sides because of the way it's set up. We might say, okay, we want to have more connections to the rail trail, and we might want to work a deal out with Mass or DCR that they actually plow the rail trail during the winter a little bit so that we can get the bicycles over there and not have to build new asphalt in the roadway.
Exactly.
So from thinking of it outside the box, and since you guys are being more touchy-feely, which I love, it, great. And you said it on TV, we got it.
I said sensitive, I didn't say
We just translated it for you.
Give me a box of tissues.
It's right there. So that is one thing that we do is we have these meetings we need to talk about because...
Those are all on the table.
Yeah, because plowing sidewalks is a big thing for us. The neighbors next door to us have a hard time plowing sidewalks, and they actually put money towards it. We have a smaller ability to plow sidewalks, and if you actually do it, we would get probably 4 miles or 5 miles of sidewalks,
okay,
which is a big deal for us.
Yeah, yeah, it's a big deal.
As the superintendent's about to chime in.
I wrote a letter back this winter yet on that proposed sidewalk from South Maple to Green Leaves over there on the south side of Route 9, and I mentioned even though the sidewalk is on the south side, it's not going to get the sun, it's not going to melt. When you guys plow the road, it's all going to be plowed right onto the sidewalk. John knows, as I do, we have that issue on this end from Middle Street all the way to the bridge where the state goes by with their plows and just dumps everything right over the top of the sidewalk. We plow the sidewalk, state comes back, it's just pushing the snow back and forth, it never seems to get taken away. It's a vicious cycle, and
makes us both look bad.
You know, we've got ADA compliance issues. We've got to maintain the roads at all times to the best of our abilities, including sidewalks. I mean, this past winter, there was a few times that we did not plow that sidewalk, that section from Middle Street, let's say, from West Street, let's say, to the bridge. We just couldn't get to it. It was just too much, and it was piled up, and we had to remove it with bucket trucks and hire police department details. I mean, it turned out to be a fiasco. So that's why I wrote to the people in Boston that wrote to the town about this other sidewalk from South Maple Street to Green Leaves over there, who's going to maintain it, but I've yet to get a response from anybody there. I sent it to a person at the Boston office. Just a few comments that
We can take this time when we're talking about the whole corridor, and we can also work to try to make a solution, which is what we need to do, or else.
Yeah, I mean,
It's not the first time we've heard this. I mean, it's an ongoing, it is an issue.
Again, you're addressing the historical part of Hadley with a bike lane. With the bike path, I agree with Guilford 100%. The bike path is a couple hundred feet up. If they could put the bike lane on the bike path.
I see, yeah. I see
this is not just for you, this is for
no, everyone. I know, I understand.
And they need to
but we're on the work with you on this.
Tell us who we need to see, and we'll make sure they get the message. The governor? Will you send it to the governor's office or what?
So, I'll save you right now. So did you have anything else you wanted to talk about?
Not on the large reconstruction project, but I expect there to be a very vigorous ongoing dialogue there.
Yep. So did you wish to talk about anything else?
Oh yeah, a few extra things that we were sent on the agenda. We went over the water line project, the limits, and the funding, and you know the kind of went in the scheduling on that. I guess one thing would be maybe the funding may not be later, but you know, it'd be good to get as soon as possible some sketches or you know the plans. For the work, because if those can be you know submitted and put in with the plans without having to have an addendum after it's been advertised, you know, makes it a little easier.
Okay. So
I'm not sure if, you know the design's progressing or.
Don't we have them already?
So we have.
They should be on there already. The plans for the water line we reviewed them several times already.
Yeah, so we've done the water main, we've given it to them all the way from Wally Street all the way to the end of this project.
Right, the existing project, but if you want to add on.
So how much are you adding on that's going to be advertised in this year?
Well, this project, it was my understanding you were discussing trying to include all the way up to East into.
But you're not actually going to actually resurface all the way up to East Street right now, are you?
No, it would just be patched, and you know, we work on the access permit, and you know, the use of, we wouldn't require the use of flowable fill, you know, it can just be compacted, and just the same pavement thickness put back, realizing we're going to be reconstructing the roadway in the future.
Yeah, there was a couple questions on that. I mean, we don't need to add engineering costs in for compaction. There's a company we can use, mm-hmm. or you people we can use for the compaction tests as we go along, or how would you? How would you honor that?
A geotech sub-consultant sounds good for compaction tests, and I believe the town would have to fund that since it would be a town project, not in conjunction with a state project.
So you're waiving that flowable fill. We just have to compact properly, proper backfill.
Just make sure it doesn't settle, you know, all the traffic and everything. So.
And we put the patch in.
Yep.
And this, so we're going from, this is from the farm museum all the way to?
A little bit past the East Street.
So that part we haven't designed yet.
No.
That design cost would be $158,000 based upon our most recent estimate, with construction estimated to be about $825,000, including that $158,000.
So then we would have to go to fall town meeting, appropriate the money, design, and we wouldn't have that available. It would have to be a change order after you awarded right now, is where we're sitting. Is that would that doable? Or
that would probably be a little too late. You know, if you could get it done a little sooner, shortly after, possibly around the advertising. And
spoke with Bayside Engineering, Mike Rizzo, the guy that did the design for us for the first section, and I asked him to look into flowable fill, what the cost would be versus the controlled density fill, and he thinks that we could be able to do that instead of using flowable fill. It wouldn't cost that much more. But his concern was the timing of phase one, and if we are out there, the timing, the construction components such as the full depth roadway excavation, drainage improvements, new sidewalks, utility poles. So in other words, this contractor for this project would have their own schedule for traffic management work as well as other different types of work. The contractor for phase two would have their own schedule for their work, which could create a lot of traffic problems. So either one contractor does the whole thing. I don't see it happening because we've got such a tight time frame on that. It's not designed yet. to put that in as just a water line project from 400 feet past the East Street, or if we do this per se on our own, we have to come up with, you know, traffic control and everything else, which might be in conflict when you guys are out there where you're doing a certain section, a certain thing where you're stopping traffic, and then the town is doing a certain thing stopping traffic. So it's, you know, it should flow together as one.
But we're a little more solidified with our numbers and our dates than we were before coming
right.
into. And I'm with the dates here and the discussion that we're having here, I'm not really in favor of talking about $800,000 worth of work when in 3 years from now it's expected to be done to begin with.
That's it, now that they got a more accurate date when they're moving
right.
ahead with the next phase.
So I don't think we need to dwell an awful lot on this conversation, because I think John's concerns were far more that, well, if this is 10 years out, we get a problem. If it's 3 years out, not so much.
Not so much.
Okay.
I agree.
So as a board, what we're saying is we're only going to do the part we designed up to the farm museum right now. We're not not ask Mass Highway to do anything else in the project.
Yeah.
So we want to move that?
So moved.
Second.
Any more discussion about that? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So that leaves for us, we need to figure out between now. And actually, we can go as far as annual town meeting, what we want to do, the schedule for the construction, design and construction of the next phase, which is probably, for you, the roadwork's probably 3 years out or 4 years out?
3 to 4, more likely 4.
So
by the time we get to a final design phase, I would expect that's assuming optimal review through, well, optimal conceptual development, best case scenario and environmental review, and
it'll be easy, right?
Maybe. But there's a lot that goes into what happens there. I think we've got, it's not on the order of 10 years, but it's on the order of 3 to 5.
Good. Excellent.
For this next segment.
Great.
So do you anything else?
The last thing on the agenda we were sent was, I'm not sure if there's any discussion on the plantings out here for the 947 project.
We still have to sign off on the plantings before you bid, right?
Yep. We need a letter and the
and
access
we have
permit.
We have to sign a permit that we'll
yep.
maintain them and
right.
sell our soul. Then.
Yep.
So we had talked a little bit.
Selling your soul for flowers.
Do we get to pick what we want?
I believe right now, I think we had some input. I know Rob had the original plan, and I'm not sure if, you know, they should be shown here. I'm not sure how they were.
They were in our last packet.
Yeah, there were
a lot of choices there.
We have initial plantings designed. There's always room for input on that. And, you know, further years, plantings are, you know, whatever committee would be, you know, replanting those four locations. So you're welcome to put input in.
So let me make sure we all understand. So most of these projects, the plantings go in and you can't really make changes to the planting schedule or planting setup for 5 years like in most of the projects, or can we, if it gets planted and something we, you know, looks a little out of whack, we want to change something, we're okay with changing it, or?
Within the planting bits.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right.
Because so you're asking for to maintain it.
Okay, so we can plant concrete or tar if we need to. Because if it's a bad winter and they're less than 4 inches, I can almost guarantee you 100% the loader will take care of them.
It might be
as they
so
have this
pruning.
Past winter.
Not loader be better. But just answer some questions.
That's chosen.
Planting this did take a beating.
The 9 feet of snow on it, everything took a beating.
Oh, yeah. So we were going to talk to some of our civic organizations to see if they might be interested in doing
they might want to maintain a corner or something.
Did that come about? Or
do you get involved with that, like with the islands that are maintained and stuff like that in other areas? Or that's basically up to us?
A lot of the, our maintenance section will take some. A lot of times we do have these permits, you know, we have them in other towns where they have the groups that will come out and help maintain them.
So do we need to approve, do you need our sign off, yes, we're gonna maintain these now, or when do you need them?
Doesn't have to be at this moment, but you know, anytime soon would be good. The project just passed 100%, you know, it's moving on to PS&E, so especially if you had any comment, additional comments on plantings, now's the time to get them to us so we can get them into the final design for bidding.
Do we have any comments now, or do we want to?
Oh, I might go see them. I want to see what they look like before I plant.
It's just a height issue, you know, with, like you were talking about, I think Joyce was making mention that Sunderland's had gotten kind of
tall.
A little tall, and that it was a little bit cumbersome for them.
But we're maintaining it, so we can limit the miracle growth.
Trim them back.
So I just want to make a point about this planting schedule. This is something that has undergone review by our landscape design section, by one of our landscape architects, who, has many years of experience with roadside plantings. And, with the best effort, obviously, there's only so much that a landscape architect can do to prevent a...
He hasn't been to Hadley yet.
I don't know if she has or hasn't, but there's only so much they can do to protect against snow and ice operations, but they are very mindful of roadside tolerance and, those sorts of things that are lower maintenance species and things like that. So you can have some, obviously we're still open to input on this, but you can have some confidence that there are experts who are looking at this, not just traffic engineers.
I have no interest in second guessing the landscape.
I try not to, but I do everybody, so.
Joyce?
I think, we're in a backyard between Stockbridge School of Agriculture, and I'm sure that they might be able to help us, maybe.
Mike?
There's an application permit process for this, I believe, that you guys sent to me for access to state highway that would have to be signed off by the town. Would that have to be done before we have someone to care for this, or does this have to be done at any time?
Yes, it would have to be done before the project's advertised.
Because it says that the maintenance of planting beds, including mulching, weeding, watering, planting flowers, maintenance of planting beds to be performed each year as constructed in 2016. The only thing that caught my eye on this permit was that it said that the property owner is MassDOT on this, even though it's going to be taken care of by the town. I guess that's what you're after, correct?
Correct. That's why we need the access permit, because it's still our layout. So.
It's in the state layout. Right. So we're getting a permit from them to go stand in the state layout to maintain the flowers. Yes. So can you give us until August, maybe, so we can talk this out, and then we'll try to get it wrapped up by August for you, so you can have the advertising. Because I know the end of August, you're going to be like rushing to get it out for September.
Right.
So, yep. Right. And then should we talk to you directly if we have some questions about the landscaping plan? To you, or?
Yeah, you can direct to the district, and we can get you in touch with whoever you need to, Boston, or the architect.
Yeah, he's got our email and cell phone, so.
Okay.
Yeah, we can, but definitely. District's the best line of communication.
Directly to you?
Sure.
Did you get the promotion? Is that you the acting? You the acting project guy now? I hadn't heard.
No, I've always been in the project section. So.
Rich got moved up.
District Highway Director is the acting.
So who's the acting project person now?
Paula Simmons.
Oh, okay. I forgot about that. Paul.
Yeah. And I'm her assistant, so.
All right. Congratulations.
More work, less acting.
There you go. All right, so is there any other questions for Mass Highway, Mass DOT?
Thank you very much
for coming. And so for those of you that were invited, we're having our kickoff meeting at the district on July 22nd. So I'm sure there'll be some news to bring back then from other voices here. So thank you all very much, and have a happy 4th of July.
You too.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Stay safe. No fireworks.
Okay. So our 7:15 appointment's done. I believe we have a group of people who wish to talk to us about asbestos. Available. Let's talk about asbestos.
Maybe town hall roof.
Oh. Town hall roof for the asbestos project. Well, let's start with the asbestos abatement. That's number, it's next on my list.
So the asbestos abatement project is not proceeding ahead. We received this morning the signed contracts from air quality experts. And so the next step is for the board to sign the contracts, and then we send them off to legal and to accounting. Then the notice to proceed can go out tomorrow. So we have a project which is moving forward. We've had a pre-construction conference with air quality experts and our designer. Looks like the contractor knows what they're supposed to be doing. The subcontractor is coordinating with them. In the meantime, we are working with the departments to prepare the building for the project, as well as setting up a satellite town hall over at the public safety complex. We're going to be closing town hall on Thursday the 9th and Friday the 10th of July in order to transfer the communication equipment and the IT equipment over to the safety complex and set everything up and get it all integrated. We'll also be doing the final clean and removal of everything that needs to be removed from the building at that time. So looks like everybody's working towards the same goal, and looks like we're on time with this project.
Can we get channel 2240 here and make sure the whole public knows, not just the town at this point? For
right, we intend to let as many people know by as many outlets as we possibly can. We have a sign outside. We're going to send out an email blast. We're going to put something on the website on that red banner. There is a notice that appeared in today's Daily Hampshire Gazette. We will be reaching out to the rest of the media.
Yeah, even a Springfield Union. I mean, there's a lot of public that comes in here, not just the town.
Right.
Citizens, you know.
We're also going to put up those signs that we use for voting around town in order to get the word out. So as many ways as we can get the information out, we will.
Okay, so you need a...
I need a vote to authorize the chair of the select board to sign the contracts.
So moved. So moved, yeah. Second.
Third.
Fourth.
Any more discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All right. So let's talk about roofs.
We opened bids for the roof. We received six bids. The apparent low bidder is U.S. Metal Roofing. Their bid came in at, let me grab my notes here.
72.
Yeah.
400.
$72,400. The project budget is $65,000. Creates a shortfall of $7,400. We can bridge this shortfall by utilizing funds from an article, Article 10. From annual town meeting of 2012 that currently has a balance of $85,000 in it. That article was there to provide repairs to both the town hall and the senior center. We've used it mostly for the senior center. We funded the second half of the roof out of the for the senior center out of that article. The drainage part of the stairs, the doors, and I've asked the Municipal Building Committee to review their future plans for utilizing that article in order to fund other projects, as well as I've asked them to comment on the budget, proposed budget for this project. So we know that we have the lowest bid of $72,400. We're estimating a 15% contingency in case there's anything that we encounter that we did not anticipate, for a total project of $83,260. We'd use $65,000 from the article that we passed back in January, and the voters approved back in January for most of the funding. We would transfer or make available from the old article, 18,260 to match the project budget. You all met last night, and I imagine you have a recommendation.
Yeah, the he's right about the 8,000. The 7,400, we have some remaining projects that we want to do over there, and you know, also some doors and stuff that we were planning on doing here. If you take the 7,400 overrun out, that leaves 78,300 or so. There's a couple other small projects that we have got lined up to be done, and that's going to bring it down to 70, which is enough to, we have the doors at the town hall here and some other small projects that we want to do over there. But one example, we had an estimate for the doors at the senior center that was, original estimate was $17,147. We actually got it done for $9,800. There's $7,300 right there that we saved just on that one project. The flat roof, the estimate was for $68,000. We actually added in two of the portico roofs that were leaking that we found out this winter. It still came in at $64,400, which was another $3,500. So just in the savings of those two estimates that we had, it came in less. There's plenty of money to cover.
So your recommendation is to do this?
Yes.
We'd like to try to expedite this as quickly as possible. David had some pretty good suggestions on trying to get that through quickly.
Yeah, so you also received a recommendation by email from our treasurer, who reviewed this project and the proposed funding plan, and she recommends going forward with the project and the funding. So if we can authorize the chair to sign the contract, if you choose to award the bid and authorize the select board chair to sign the contract, we can expedite the paperwork, get that going, and issue the notice to proceed so that we can do it in conjunction with Eversource, which apparently is the main determinant in this project, because they have to
the wires. They have to move the wires over. And
10 feet.
And this is the perfect time to do it. It's right before storm season. They said, you got us at the right time, Dave. With Willie's help and the knowledge of his people that he knows over there, we got it already timed. So it's very, very critical that we get this thing going so everything gels. So we got to kind of really expedite this.
And he's also going to try to do it while the town hall is shut down.
Okay.
I make a motion to authorize the chair to sign the contract.
Got enough ink in your pen there, Mr. Chairman?
I'm right.
I second it.
And to award the bid to
U.S. Metals.
And they're also the ones that did the senior center rules, so we've got a good track record.
Molly has a question.
Yeah, I mean, I've got no issue with moving forward with this, but I just, so the funding plan, so we're still taking 18,260 from Article 10. 2012
potentially. If we don't run into any contingencies, then it would only be the $7,400.
Right. So my question is just, there's not a copy of that article in
right
here?
Mm-hmm.
Not Article 10.
Not 10. Yeah.
The current one is, the 65, but not the one. And I just want to make sure we're confident that the way that article was voted at town meeting, there's absolutely no problem using it for this purpose.
Right. We double-checked the article. We cleared it with Gail Wanda to make sure that she would sign the contract, that there would be funding in place. So that was the first place we went, is can we use this money for this project?
And that was one that didn't get pigeonholed by
the other ones.
So it's nothing with CPA funding or anything? It's
no,
a
right.
Pure town meeting vote?
Right.
Correct.
Perfect.
Okay. Any other questions? Discussions?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you.
Thank you.
Get it done. Good job. Keep up the good work, committee.
So I just want to pass this out. This is the update of our critical needs list. The one one line that you want to see, the column, is status. With the C's. C's mean they're completed. You'll notice that we've got quite a number of the projects done, finalized. And
The other ones are in the works, and we should be in good shape. Now, as you see, as Gary said, the pigeonholing is a little bit of a problem for us. I'm trying to get some of the things worked out, and we're going to do that, and hopefully we can remedy that issue at the next town meetings.
Okay, good.
Okay.
Excellent.
Good.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
And congratulations, you were reappointed this morning, earlier.
Oh.
If you look at the status right next to it, it's left over. So it was completed in that $540 left over. So almost every one of those is could save a little bit of money here and there.
Right. Find a new place to spend it as soon as it gets freed up.
Yep,
we already have that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Police chief, you wish to talk to us.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah, I got a couple of things.
Well, we'll do some of them. I think there's one that you may have to stay for.
Okay. One of them is surplus vehicle.
We've already done that.
We did that in the consent calendar for the and the personnel change was done.
That's all done too?
Yes.
Okay, so I have one item. I had a meeting with our main constable. We now have two. One of them is Rich Downey, and the other one's Bill Banner. I had a meeting with him recently just to talk about his duties as a constable and you know, what was expected of him. We're going to work him into some of our trainings to make sure that he is up to date on everything that he's supposed to be up to date on. But the police chief, at least in this town, doesn't really have a whole lot of control over what a constable does. So he does his postings for warrants and things, goes to the elections and stands a post. And one of the concerns that I had, because we do pay him out of our budget, was his rate of pay. It's $11.17. Some agencies pay per posting, some agencies pay by the hour. So I had looked at that, and maybe I'm not as up to date on minimum wage statutes and things as I should, but I'm not even certain if that's meeting that requirement. And I did, with the help of Jess Spank, they will do a kind of a mini wage study. And we got several, we looked at several different towns and cities. And like I said, he makes $11.17 an hour. And, you know, we're getting anywhere from $12, $13, up to $20 and $25 an hour, which is what a lot of people pay for their constables. So he works very minimal hours, obviously. You know, we can look at a calendar and know what his hours are. And I just thought that maybe it was time to take a look at that and possibly raise that wage to a more applicable rate. Our special police officers make $15 an hour. That's the lowest rate of pay that we pay for any of our officers, and I thought that it may be a good jumping off point. And I thought it might be something that the board may want to chew on a little bit and think about.
Questions?
Would it be prudent to do this as a one-off, or should we put it in the context of the wage study discussion that we're going to be having? I know it's not a lot of, I mean, well, actually, let me rephrase that. Based on what you've said, how many how many dollars does it translate into your budget?
He works some road shifts, too.
He does, but that's totally separate.
It's paid up.
It's only as a constable you're speaking of.
Correct, only as a constable. And like I said, you can look at the calendar really and kind of see what his hours are. He does both town meetings and special elections and warrant postings. And I think he does the warrant postings in, you know, a couple of hours. So you're talking about annually. I can only refer back to since I started doing payroll when Chief Huckowitz fell ill. You're talking 20 hours.
He's amicable to this?
Certainly.
Yeah. Are you sure he's okay with this?
Getting a raise in pay, yes, I think he's okay with it.
I make
we did discuss it.
So we're talking an $80 impact.
Yeah, roughly. Very minimal. Yeah. Very, very minimal.
Again, I don't have any issue. Makes perfectly good sense to me. My only question is just, do we need to be concerned that $15 is stacking up against somebody else that's now going to say, Well, if they're getting 15, then we should be getting 16, 17. I don't know.
Well, all the special officers get 15, so we're bringing them up to the lowest pay. The lowest special.
Right, but our special officers, do they have more responsibility or different responsibility than the constable that they would argue that they then are now deserving of an increase?
Well, we could do a dollar less.
I imagine they would actually, well.
I mean, you could, why don't we look at the wage?
That's why I bring up, maybe it's something to think about rather than make.
Why don't we look at your wage study that you have, if we could get that and the rest.
So would you want to wait and look at it some more, or we want to do something tonight?
I'm ready tonight.
I'd prefer to wait, just for the reasons stated, and they both have my phone number, so.
But Mr. Bannock is not pressing the issue. Rich Downey actually hasn't even brought it up. Rich is still trying to roll himself into the constable role, so Bill is still doing the majority of the town work. Mm-hmm. So I don't think either one of them would have an issue waiting. Like I said, it's not, it wasn't really brought by him, it was more brought by me because I noticed the hourly wage and I thought maybe we should take a look at it at least.
Yeah, that's a good heads up.
You walked in a little late because I had a couple of budgetary issues when you weren't here.
Oh.
What is your projected budget issues, deficits in particular, over the next year and into the next fiscal year? I know you're doing what you can with the part-time officers and the specials, but you got quite a deficit there that we're working with, and we're trying to work our way out of it.
Are you here? You're just looking at the overtime as being your main issue going forward?
Yes. Yeah, I mean, overtime is obviously the major concern. The only other one that we've identified right now, which in the 3 months that I've been doing it, is our communications department expenses. There's a bit of a deficit there, but we've looked into, with the boiler, the impact of the new boiler, alterations in some of the phone bill issues that we've been able to take care of and save some money there. We've instituted some policies to save on gasoline and things like that. So we're kind of picking just in the short time, but the overtime is glaring.
Okay.
All
right. Do we want to take up this issue with the constable now, or we want to wait a little bit more?
I'd just like to see the numbers for other towns.
How many towns did you survey in your?
Jessica actually emailed it to me. I want to say there's 20 on there, 15 or 20. But I can put together a more readable sheet. She just kind of typed it out quick for me.
Okay, that'd be great.
Yeah.
All right. So that's all you have, or you want?
It was just the other two issues, but if they're taken care of, then that's all I got.
Okay. All right. Are you going to stay for the other topic at the end of the meeting? You don't have to, I believe, but.
Which one is that?
The negotiations.
Oh, sure.
All right.
Not much to do.
You don't need to stay if you don't want to. That's the only thing else we have. Yeah. Okay. Let's get on to the telecommuting policy.
So this is something that we thought might be helpful to have in place, both in terms of the asbestos project as well as planning for the future for our emergency management plan. Looking at moving all of Town Hall over to a small, not a small room, but a mid-sized room over at the public safety complex, putting people in various offices, wondering about the security issues. I can foresee that there would be a request from some department heads to work from home. Certainly the elected officials can do that. That's their right to determine how they want to work. But non-elected departments may ask for this consideration. So I thought it might be helpful to have a telecommuting policy in place. These are very apparently not popular in Massachusetts. I had to go to the city of Madison, Wisconsin, in order to find an example. But basically, it sets out who's eligible for telecommuting, sets up an advanced a permission process, a letter of agreement, and certain measurables that can be used in order to measure performance. Some do's and don'ts, but this might be helpful for both this project as well as in the future should we ever be in a position of having to relocate all or part of our town functions to another site.
Okay, any discussion?
That's good.
I have no real issue with the policy. I think that for the immediate concern, I'd be more than happy to suggest that we approve it specifically for the move.
Mm-hmm.
But I'd like to hold on making it a permanent one until we can put it in the context of the overall personnel policy. But, mm-hmm. but I will go on record saying I'm not at all opposed to us having a telecommuting policy.
Mm-hmm.
We just want to make sure we cross our T's and dot our I's in terms of making it measurable and all that.
It would be the responsibility of the employee utilizing the telecommuting opportunity to observe all laws of the state of Massachusetts, Commonwealth of Massachusetts, including the state ethics law. So there would have to be some education as to what we can use this for and what we shouldn't.
Okay. Any other discussion?
No.
Molly, I think you have a motion on your head.
I make a motion that we approve the telecommuting policy is presented on a temporary basis during the move of town hall employees.
Second.
Any other discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you.
All right. Holly Road again and Laurel Drive. We're ready to do something.
Did the chair want to address the gentleman there?
What is he here for?
I'm not sure.
Joe Fiore with Nexamp. David, I know we spoke about potentially having me speak just briefly, building a solar project nearby. And I know one of the things that's before the selectmen is to determine is to really sign off on the net metering agreement. And I don't know if you all have been briefed on that, what level of knowledge there is, but I wanted to comment, if there are concerns, see if I can address them as we try to move forward with this agreement and with the goal of moving to construction for the next couple weeks, months, to get the project online operational this fall, so that the town can begin to receive credits from the project and a discount on their electric bill.
Okay, I'm the guy that kind of stimulated this conversation, so if it's okay with you.
Sure.
My name's Jerry, so, I'll see. I don't know. My fear is getting into another 20-year agreement with the town. We've, at this point in time, 70% of our utilization is committed to a 20-year project. Technology, everything moves along very quickly. If we're commit 100% of ours to a 20-year plan and something else comes up down the road, I feel as though we've done the town a disservice by signing up today. And the 16% is great. I mean, that's good. It's not as good as 21, but 16 is good. But I don't necessarily, I'm not excited about getting involved with another 20-year contract and tying up 100% of the town's availability.
Sure.
For that.
Sure. And
okay.
That's completely understandable. I wanted to shed some light on the recent policy initiatives that are coming down the pike to give you a sense of how these laws are going to change over the next couple months to see if that provides a little bit of clarity, because 20 years is a long time. So right now Massachusetts really has the most lucrative net metering policies in place, meaning the level of incentives are such that as solar developers, we can build a project, make a profit, and offer a considerable discount to the town or whatever entity is receiving the credits. right now National Grid, they've hit their cap. So the amount of solar that National Grid can take on has been reached. And there's this kind of huge policy debate that is basically saying that they're not going to raise the cap until the net metering incentive structure is changed. And now WMECO, Eversource, the cap has not been hit, but you know, within the next 6 months to a year, it will be hit, and they're going to be subject to whatever new law comes our way. So I don't know exactly what that new law is going to be like, but I do know that the Baker administration and others, they want to change it so that it's less lucrative for developers and in turn for towns that are receiving a discount. So that's just kind of the background of the policy, is that we have this window right now to grandfather these projects in under the current incentive structure. And my suggestion would be to take advantage of it before the laws change. You know, 10 years down the road, there can certainly be other policies and technologies in place, and I can understand your concern about that. But I would say, you know, in the foreseeable future, 5 to 10 years, the deal you're going to see right now is only going to change. It's only going to get worse, in my opinion. And you can read about the net metering laws, the big policy issue right now that really has our company concerned, because we don't know what the changes are going to be. We just know that they're not going to be as good. So there's a window right now to lock in these agreements, and 60% of what we used in the last agreement actually with the town. We built another project in Hadley.
What are we, a year into now? 2 years into?
I think two years into. So that was 60%. It's the same exact contract. And
it was 21.
21.
So those are under SREC 1.
Oh, it was under SREC 1. Yes. It's a different program. The SREC value is, we're in SREC 2 now, and the value is much less, which is sort of trying to reflect.
So is in this agreement, is there a way to get out of it if we both agree to getting out of it?
It's a 20-year agreement, so we can certainly work with the town to allocate the credits to a different public entity, which we've done in the past. Let's say your load shrinks greatly, or for whatever reason you want to get out, we will work with you to do that. If we can't find someone, then the agreement states that we can pursue liquefied damages, etc.
So it's no.
Yeah.
It's no.
Well, it's we can assign them. So it's not like we wouldn't work with you in good faith to assign them to another party. We've done that in the past.
But you're not legally obligated to do so.
Right. Well, if we can't find someone, in a reasonable time period, then.
The contract does say that they have to work with us in order to assign the
credit. It does, yeah. It does say we will work with you here.
So if we find a deal better than 16%, someone else is be able to get a deal that's worth 16%.
Yeah.
So then,
you see where we're kind of going with? If that 16 was 21, maybe we'd have a different conversation here right now.
Yeah. No, I understand.
You didn't really say that, but I did.
But what's our... We signed the agreement tomorrow. We're talking about 30% of the energy for the town. What's the number?
Over a 20-year period, we're estimating a savings of somewhere around $93,000.
Over a 20-year period? Yeah. For this agreement?
For
just the sake of the agreement.
Okay. That's the lower end of the rate.
Okay. I think seems a bit low to me. I know that there was about $90,000, and I sent you our proposal, so you're probably going off that. I know it was about $90,000 in costs that you guys currently have that we would be assigning credits to at a 16% discount. So that's about $14,000 in year one savings.
I think the annual savings was estimated to be around $12,000.
Okay, so it could buy 85% of the.
What is your math?
12 times 20.
How about 4,650? $4,650.
Well, here's the figures right now. We're going to get that number. 12,648 the first year.
Right.
In the 20th year, it's 20,164.
I see that. 93,000 divided by 20 years is 4,650.
Yeah, so it's 322,000.
Yeah, cumulative savings.
Cumulative savings is 322.
Yeah. Here's where you're not at your percentage.
I mean, to be honest, if the question was, do we want to lock ourselves into a 20-year agreement and the only savings is $92,000, I'm out.
Yeah, for sure.
So it's 322.
It's 322, yeah.
Well, that's pretty good for 20 years.
And that first one at 21% was, Jesus,
We were looking at a range of low 300,000 to 600,000.
I thought it was like 540 or something. Yeah. Somewhere near.
Yeah. So, and it was off a larger number, right? It was 21% off of.
That's the number.
We're going off
the full amount. Yeah.
Right.
It's a cumulative breakdown of what we already have in place. On top of this.
Okay, how we've been doing versus the numbers were originally projected?
Well, very well. We're right on track towards the $600,000 end of the range.
I mean, it's a percent discount, right? So as the WMECO rate increases, the dollar savings amount increases as well because it's 60% of a larger number. So
this is how they
came. If you think rates, that's the other factor. If you think rates are going to continue to increase, which
that's
the trend of the last 20 years, that estimated
savings. Whatever stays the same, everything increases.
Exactly. That's why we usually do a percent discount offer because it protects you so that if rates decrease, you're still always guaranteed 16%. If they increase, you get the 60%, and it's 60% of a greater number. So,
have we already done due diligence on NextAmp just in terms of their going concern?
Yes.
So
we became involved with NextAmp through the first agreement, first net metering credit agreement. They had done a review process through the Hampshire Council of Governments, so they had gone through an RFQ. And so we're very comfortable working with NextAmp on issues having to do with pilots and net metering credits.
Yeah, I mean the other.
Just to amplify on that, we have been approached by other outfits, most notably the outfit that built the solar array on Huntington Road that we were very uncomfortable with and decided not to have anything to do with. So, yes, we've gone through some of that review.
I obviously didn't give the background of NextAmp, but our big selling points are, we were founded locally here in Massachusetts, office in Boston, April. We're the largest commercial developer in Massachusetts. And our model is to own and operate all of our projects. So it's besides the discount, that's the number of one other consideration is the strength of the company. And this is a very crowded field now. And so we like to think that we have projects in over 100 towns that we build up a reputation. If it wasn't good, you'd hear it loud and clear, and David would not have moved forward with us, but it is what it is. We're proud of what we built over the last 10 years or so.
And you should be. No disrespect to that at all. I'll tell you where I was heading with this. I'm a director of the Hampshire Three County Fair, and their solar panels, they're not able to sell it to us. And then I talked to some of the farmers that are in town that have solar panels on top of their buildings, and they're not able to sell it to us. A farm with an APR that has an APR sold off of it isn't allowed to generate more than 1.2% of what 20% more than what they actually use on the farm, and they have to save that 20% in as they grow. So they put the they put everything up there on top of the roof, figuring they're going to grow some, and being allowed to put it 20% more than what their actual use is today. But they're not in the capabilities of selling that back to us in the form of credits. So I was reaching out to our farmers to see if there was an opportunity there for us to benefit and for them to benefit by selling their credits to us as well.
No, they're considered more of a residential rather than a commercial setup like these guys.
This project, which I should also mention, is on Allard's farm. So it is on a farm. The lease payments are going to, I think it's Wayne Goulet, who we've worked with in the past, and he's a great guy. And so, you know, we are directly,
indirectly, yeah.
You know, he's receiving substantial benefit from those panels. And ideally, we always want to sell the credits to the host town. This project is permitted. You know, it's been through the conservation and planning board. It's fully permitted. So that's the other kind of driving factor, is this thing's coming online this year. As the town, you have full sort of control. You've seen that process through, so you can be rest assured that going forward.
I'm going to make a motion to enter into a meeting agreement, credit agreement with Nexamp and its successors for the project on Mill Valley Road as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
One question. So we have been authorized, or one clarification. We have been authorized by town meeting to enter into an agreement more than 3 years.
That's
that was
right.
Done last in the fall. In this annual time.
We took a generic vote two years ago that allows us to get into that metering credit agreement. So I ran that past council. He said it's a valid vote, so yes.
All right. So any other discussion, questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you for clarification.
Appreciate the question. The other thing I should bring up, this will not change this in any way, is that this project is a community shared solar project, which means that half of the credits can go to homeowners and residents. It does not impact in any way the deal with the town. It's totally optional whether the town wants to promote it to residents, but it's sort of an exciting opportunity for the town. Every single resident in Hadley can basically enter into a similar deal as the town. The big difference is that they're not committed to 20 years. They can back out. They have to give us a 6-month warning, but there's no termination fee. It's just a sign-up process. So we're excited about that, and we're always looking for the town to kind of support it, or even just to sign homeowners up. I know you guys are all homeowners in town.
And what's their financial benefit to that?
It's a 15% fixed discount.
So take using me as an example, I have a house that faces east-west. I have a slate roof.
Yeah.
I can't get any solar onto my house that would make any sense. So this would be an opportunity for me to get a discount on my electricity by buying into the panel. I live in Greenfield, so this would not be eligible, but just hypothetically,
yeah,
someone in my situation could be buying it.
So do you have advertising material you have? You
didn't bring any. I have a website, and I do have tons of marketing material that I would love to disperse.
That's fine. Actually, if you bring some in, we'll see if we can get it put on our TV website. TV site.
And what kind of capacity do you have?
It's about a megawatt AC, so it's exactly half of the project. It amounts to about 200 homes. We have about 100 of those homes already filled up, so I would expect within the next month or so, because we're partnering with Hampshire Council of Governments and they're promoting it, and mm-hmm. You know, every day there's just more homeowners that are basically like, it's to support a local solar project, I don't have to put panels on my roof, and no cost, I get a 15% discount on my electricity. So there's a driving appetite, but
And it's not a 20-year contract.
It's a six-month notice to get out.
Okay. Well, if you get us information, we'll be happy to help you out.
So I know that in other towns there's been problems with homeowners getting into these arrangements and then finding out they have to pay taxes on the panel as well. So
yeah.
We should make sure that we are very clear as to what we're signing other folks up for, whether we're giving them a tax bill that they hadn't planned on.
I don't know if we talked about this in any detail, but...
No, we haven't.
Okay,
so
yeah.
I'm just raising it as a concern.
So if you get us more information, we'll be happy.
Yeah, I'll double... Like, in talking with the DOER and stuff, it's not a sale of electricity, so there's no tax associated with it. It's just a transfer of credits. But I'll certainly...
Let's just be clear on that. People don't get a nasty surprise.
Right. Right. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you all. I appreciate it.
Nice to meet you.
Have a good holiday.
Okay. Holly and Laurel.
So I talked to Ms. Everett of Koppelman and Page about the questions that were raised by Planning Board having to do with the title for Laurel and Holly. And she made a recommendation as a blanket legal procedure that we should always do a title search on any property the town is thinking about acquiring. And so a title search for Holly Road and for Laurel Drive is entirely appropriate. And she made the further recommendation that this should be a cost that's borne by the abutters.
The abutters.
The abutters.
The people that want
to petitioner.
Petitioners.
Do we have an
petitioner? Petitioners, nothing. I mean, to me, an abutter is somebody who's next door.
This would be the people who abut the road that's...
The road abutters.
The road abutters.
Excellent.
There we go.
Thank you.
So did you let them know?
What's the projected cost?
She did not give it to me, but I'm thinking, you know, these things run around $3,000. They're not wildly expensive.
For the whole road?
Unless there's some sort of real complication.
That's for the whole road?
This would be for a property in general.
One piece of property.
Yeah.
You mean Holly Road?
Well, but it's the
yeah.
road.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One road or the other.
Yeah.
So at the planning board meeting, we kind of agreed that we would do the one, we would pay for Holly Road's title.
You did?
No.
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 No,
we said
it,
we would,
it came up. But
so you move it along?
At that point in time, I don't think they were assuming that the clear title was by Roberts.
They were assuming a lot of things.
Exactly, and the planning board said that they felt as though it was not as clear cut. So
before we vote to lay out either one, we want to ask the petitioner to provide a title search, is what we want to do?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes.
Yes, yes, no.
In the meantime, I've included both Holly Road and Laurel Drive on the special town meeting warrant, the preliminary special town meeting.
That we certainly did say we would do.
Yeah,
yeah.
So that part
that
is done.
So Laurel, they're having the survey done already.
Right, you have
information. Set of plans. He has to receive an as-built set of plans, but of course still missing is that one water shutoff that no one seems to be able to find for a house service. But Randy was down the other day. I dropped a copy off of David. I put one in the planning board box already.
And that was all done at that petitioner's expense?
Yes.
So Holly Road, refresh my memory, how many abutters to the road on Holly Road? Is it just like five?
No.
Was
it
17?
It's like a couple of dozen.
On Holly Road?
On Holly Road.
20 other houses? Were that many?
There's only like 12 or 14.
Yeah, the most.
But they're more than 10.
Yeah.
I mean, we're estimating about $3,000.
Question.
Okay.
You know, you got two different situations here. Laurel has only got water on it. Holly has an easement on it some way, somehow, for the wastewater. and nobody's taking that into consideration. So you really have two unique situations here. Mm-hmm. They're not both the same.
Mm-hmm. And what's your point, though?
I don't know. I'm leaving it at that for some other ideas.
So what's our preference?
I think we should go back to the at the recommendation of Kaufman and Page. Go back to the road abutters.
For both projects.
Mm-hmm.
And ask them to provide title.
Mm-hmm.
To do a title
search.
Okay. Is that a motion?
Motion.
Is that a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain. All inform them.
Who would you inform? I would think everybody on that street's entitled to have that for information, not just people that have come to us. Because some people may be wanting to pay that, some people may not want to be paying it.
Yeah,
but I think in our communication to the street would be that this was brought forward to us as a plan that at the recommendation of the town's attorneys, Copelman and Page, that the people that are petitioning to have this done should have this laid out or have the title searched on it, and then at that point in time that's our starting point.
So I met with the residents of Holly Road and we set up a contact person, so I would contact that person and say this is information that everybody needs.
Excellent.
To
if it's been done previously, I'm sorry for
the moral. Yeah, there's just one person running that.
Correct.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So
okay.
All right. All right, Conservation Commission, River Rules. We've been asked.
They said that they'd be here and they're not.
Well, let's delay it then.
We'll just, yeah.
Who are we expecting?
This Passover.
Yep. So, to review the town administrator evaluation format. So we've all had a chance to look this over. Do we want to make any changes? Are we okay with this format?
I'm able to work within the format.
Fine.
I have a little problem with boxes, but I'm okay.
There's a lot of lines underneath you guys. Right? Not enough lines, but there's a few lines on the bottom.
Change the geometric figure for you. Triangle.
Too many lines lately. Okay.
So move forward.
So we'll adopt this for the next round. We're gonna adopt this for this round.
Mm-hmm.
And we take the town administrator to present his evaluation next meeting.
I'm sorry, what's the next meeting? I missed what you just said.
July 15th.
Right. But what are we doing in July 15th?
The town administrator will present his
he's going to do his right.
Yes.
Okay.
So at that point, then we'll be able to evaluate his presentation and evaluate his for the next meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll use this form to guide us in how we mark.
Okay.
So everyone's.
I just want to be fair. If we get this move going on in our next meetings in 2 weeks, and in this next 2 weeks we got an awful lot of things going on with the move, is it enough time to get it done?
If I run into trouble, can I ask for a deferment?
Sure. I got one yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Two, three.
For a deferment?
Yep.
You can ask.
Okay, it's getting close
to
the
closer than I'm going to get you.
Okay, good. So, next item of business, we need to open the warrant for the special town meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion of the warrant?
We have some housekeeping articles that are there. This is all pretty straightforward. I'll just confine my comments to the articles that are not there, but I think it should. We have Lorena Lane, the sewer project, came in under budget. We set aside $275,000 for that project. It looks like the costs are going to be very close to $244,000. So we, as a housekeeping article, we should return the balance of that money back to the sewer reserves from whence it came.
Mm-hmm.
We should just go ahead and put that in there.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we're looking to close the warrant on the 26th, August 26th.
Right.
So if anybody wishes to add an article to it, you have until the 26th to do that, right?
Right, and I'll send out notices to every department, agent, official, committee, board, that it's open season until the 26th.
Okay, and we can post something on the TV station?
Yep.
And the website?
And the website.
Okay. All right, any other discussion? All right. All those in favor, open the warrant.
Aye.
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 All right.
Sewer pump number four.
Project update.
As the board, I received a few emails from Pine Bond on June 22nd. Significant rainfall over the previous weekend and the stormwater entered the new wet well at pump station number four. Water also entered the dry well of the new below grade pumping station. As a result of the flooding within the dry well, new electrical equipment within the pumping station dry well was submerged and damaged. This is from Ty and Bob to Edward Schultz, the contractor. In our opinion, the flooding that occurred as in the pump station is not currently operable, and the wet well, dry well, and electrical equipment were not properly protected. So as time progressed, I asked Ty and Bond to look into this, of course, since this is such a major concern of ours. And just the other day, which was June 30th, I received an email back from Charlie Tripp. And I'll just read what it says briefly here. I spoke with Schultz Construction, and Schultz intends to replace all electrical components within the pump station that were present at the time of flooding in accordance with our request letter. This would include the motors, control panel, fan, etc. Schultz has requested a quote from Gorman Rupp, that's the pump manufacturer, to replace these components. Schultz intends to pay for the replacement of these components using their insurance policy. So that weekend we had a tremendous amount of rain. The rain from Bay Road ran into there, and I asked about that, and I believe before we have that accepted, we should do a pressure test on that line so it does not happen again. So that's where we are with that. If you want a little greater detail, I have some more, or not, I won't.
I have one question. Did it flood last night?
No.
It hasn't? Okay. So we've had two more rain events since then,
right,
and neither one of them has flooded.
Right. They made a dam.
The berm is considerably higher,
right,
at this point in time, and there's a filtration right next to it as well.
Correct.
I was down there and had some conversations with Mike and I think with John as well. In the course of it's, you know, that was like Pontchartrain. There was a levee on the outside that was keeping the water out. And by driving over that berm each and every day constantly, that the berm was worn down. So it might have been there when they started, but it was significantly less when the rains came.
Okay.
Fair?
And they were aware of it throughout the whole project. It's not the first time it had flooded. So
are they asking for a time extension at this time? Or are they just telling us they're going to repair everything and they'll come back and talk to us later?
I believe that they're going to be, if I'm not mistaken, John, you deal with these, are going to be asking for a time extension because of getting all this equipment replaced.
I don't think there's any time frame right now.
I just
can't imagine Gorman Rupp having that stuff on a shelf at this point.
It took how long the last time to get those motors?
Well, their parts are readily available, common wear parts, but a motor, I know if we pull a motor out to have it repaired, it's a matter of a couple of weeks to repair it, and it's a matter of 6 to 8 weeks to get a new one.
Right.
You know, just from my experience in repairing some of these stations in the past.
Okay.
So I can foresee an extension coming.
Okay, so there's no request for us to take any action right now. This is all information.
Yeah.
Right.
Was there any other effect to this flooding?
Not that I'm aware of. Just that. station with all the new panels and the new pumps in it.
The electrical inspector's been notified, so I would really consider him the most important man on the job here right now to make sure the conduit needs to be all drained. The wire, I don't know if they're going to pull the wires and replace them. I don't know what else internally is exposed, but I spoke with Willie a couple times and he's aware of the whole situation.
Well, I'm no expert, so I'm not pretending to be, but Ty and Bond is our project manager on this, and I would like some type of confirmation from them that there's nothing retroactively that we need to be concerned of, whether it's the housing for the unit itself down there, if anything was done for damage there, in that it wasn't 100% completed at this time.
They're involved with the manufacturer right now, so what I would like to see is not only Willie involved, the engineer involved, but I want to see a letter from Gorman Rupp that says everything we're sending them will be a brand new pump station when we put the wires to it and start it over.
Yeah, so both the contractor and the engineer have to exercise their due care of the site of the project. So it's incumbent upon both of them to make the situation correct. We did a little bit of an internal investigation into the facts of the matter. One of the things that emerged is that we did not have a key to the new construction. So even if we had been aware, which we were not, of the flooding that was going on, we didn't have access to it. There was nothing that we could do. This is entirely upon them to make right and to guarantee to us that the work that has gone into replacing the motors and the electrical and the pumps is good as new.
Yeah. And to their credit, they're standing up to the plate and saying, this is us.
In the past, throughout the job, we worked in good faith with them when they were away for a couple of days and they asked us to keep an eye on it because we regularly checked that station. We had done it, so, but we weren't aware of the situation that came forth here just over that weekend.
Okay.
The amount of rain we had.
All right, that sounds good. So, we're now at the point of our meeting where we need announcements. We do have an event going on at, was it this weekend?
Pardon me?
Porter Phelps House, is that the
you posted? Porter Phelps Hadley.
Yes.
Hadley Day, where anyone who lives in Hadley gets in for free.
Yes, at Porter Phelps. And that's on the TV. I can't remember what station number it is.
192.
191, 192.
Okay. Anything else? July 4th is coming up.
Happy 4th of July.
Yep. Flavors is going to be at the fireworks, sponsored by the town of Amherst and the town of Hadley. So I think a couple other people
Who's
are going.
Are we covering that?
Fireworks. The fire department is going to be involved in the obviously that portion, and we're going to do our darndest to help people not get hit by cars on 116.
Okay. All right, so we have two. Oh, any other outlets?
Yeah, so next Thursday and Friday, Town Hall will be closed for preparation for our big move.
Okay. And then we have two executive items if we wish to talk about them.
Mm-hmm. Make a motion to go into executive session.
Not to read and read.
For the purpose of personnel, discipline, or dismissal of or complaints or charges brought against a public officer, employee, staff member, individual, DPW Water Division, and to discuss strategy and respect to collective bargaining for the DPW Police Dispatch Collective Bargaining Units.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
As Chair of the Hadley Select Board, I state that the Board has moved and seconded to enter into executive session and that the state, and I state that discussing this matter in open session will have an adverse effect on the town of Hadley. We will not reconvene after this. Roll call.
Roll call vote. Abstain.
Devine, yes.
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 Yeah.